training is very important for 2 reasons. First of all, there's the safety aspect of it.
You take
one
long push
That is why I feel that you are a good Jack Lloyd, I thought this for the day. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure.
Hello and welcome all of you to yet another episode of Quarterdeck. Today the MarineBiz TV camera crew is at the premise of a company called Danube. Well, today's Quarterdeck is like a notice. And if you notice this notice, you will notice that this notice is worth noticing. So, today's Quarterdeck is with a very prestigious man, a very famous man as far as UAE is concerned. And he is the maestro of Danube. May I now welcome Mr. Sajan to the Quarterdeck show. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Srijit, coming to our office and taking this interview.
So, Mr. Rizwan Sajan, I call you as Rizwan or Sajan?
You call me as Rizwan, that's more comfortable for you. Okay.
Tell us something about Danube, for example, the history, the growth and so on, because some people are born with a silver spoon in the mouth. You know, their parents have done everything for them and you have to just sit and manage your company. Some people, it's a struggle business and they have big stories to tell, small stories to tell, difficult stories to tell. Which category do you fall under?
I come from the lowest category, okay. I would say. When I say the lowest category, I was born in a very middle class family.
Mm-hmm.
My father was an employee in a company called Nathani Steel Private Limited. He expired at the age of 16.
Oh.
So when I was 16.
Okay.
So when he expired at the age of 16, when I was 16, you can imagine I was the only breadwinner for the house. I had my brother, my sister to support and my mom. It was not easy. So from that level, today it is what Rizwan Sajan is. Initially, it so happened that I was working in India and then I got a chance to go to Kuwait because my uncle was working over there. He happened to call me in Kuwait. He was in the same business of building material. So he's the one who has taught me how to do business, how to take forward business. I started with him with a small training, but then when I left him, I was one of his right hand. I would have probably never left him. It was because of Saddam Hussein who came and invaded Kuwait that we all had to run away from there. And we had to leave everything back in Kuwait. I had to go back in India. And that's how we decided that I should come and start something in Dubai. So that's the journey. Like from bottom I reached something to Kuwait. I made something for myself. And again coming back to zero and again had to start something in Dubai. In Dubai I worked with one company for 1 year and then I said to myself I should start my own business because that was the age where if I don't start my business probably I would never be able to do that. I didn't have any money and especially in building material if you want to do business you require a lot of money. Why I say require a lot of money because in this part of the world you need to give a lot of credit. So if you have to do a business of 1 million dirham, you have to have at least 8 to 10 million dirham capital with you. Mm-hmm. Then only you can do 1 million dirham business. Now the problem is when you have 8 to 10, you have to invest 8 to 10 million dirhams and you do business of 1 million dirham, the break-even formula doesn't come in. So it was a very difficult task as to whether to start the business or not. So what I decided was I started a brokerage company. Brokerage means it's an indenting company where I am somebody wants to buy something and somebody wants to sell something. And I would be a mediator.
Mm-hmm.
Now that is what we were doing in Kuwait and that experience I thought I would bring it to Dubai. That I would be a mediator in between the buyer and the seller and I would make my 1%, 2% custom mission where you don't require to really invest the money.
Mm-hmm.
Now that is possible to be a mediator only if you are a well experienced person mm-hmm. because otherwise nobody will let you stand in the market. All said and done, I had the 8 to 10 years experience in Kuwait being a mediator in between the buyer and the seller. But still, when I came to Dubai to sell to some people over here, it was not easy because people in Dubai are much bigger than the buyers who are there in Kuwait. Mm-hmm. So when I used to go and approach them that, boss, I am a mediator, I can sell you so-and-so from so-and-so company, and they would laugh, look at me and laugh. I said, boss, why would I want to buy through you? I already know this company and I can buy at much better price than you can offer to me. Well, I struggled for a while. But then it was a break which I got through. I got an agency of a product which was a very useful agency, which I got it through the connection of mine in Kuwait. And with that agency, I approached again the same buyers and I said, look, now I have the agency and you need to buy from me, however big you are. But this product only you can buy from me. And that is why I started that career. That went on for a while. While I was selling that product which I was holding the agency, I started selling the other products also. But again, you know, couple of years doing only brokerage business, making that 1%, 2% commission was taking you nowhere. Taking you nowhere means I used to make about 50, 60, 70,000 dirhams at the end of the month. But with the expenses and all that, it was 10, 15,000 dirhams which I used to make for myself. Mm-hmm. Which I would earn, work for somebody and make that money. So I said, okay, now need to move a little forward. I need to do some trading. Now doing trading means buying material on your own and selling to somebody, which allows you 10-15% margin. If you do that. But the problem is to do trading you require lots and lots of money. I don't have the money, so what to do? I approached all the suppliers whom I knew and I told them, boss, I don't have the money, but you know me as a Rizwan for so long time. Our relation is there for such a long time. So give me the material on credit. I will sell the material in the market and remit you the money back. As God was kind, the suppliers were kind. They started trusting me and they started sending me the material, and that is how I came into the trading. So it was a rough journey. It took me about 3 years for me to establish. The first million which I made was on the fourth year, because 3 years was my establishment time. And it's only in the fourth year when I was really, you know, up to the market that I was able to do that. I was lucky enough that the market was in my favor. Otherwise, in today's market, even to survive for 1 year is difficult. If anybody wants to start new business today, it's not easy because the market is much, much tougher. But at that time, everybody remembers that Dubai was in a growing period, and you know that the construction boom was happening. Mm-hmm. And okay, not as much as it was happening in 2005, 2008, but it was still, Dubai was still building. And if you look at before 15 years what Dubai was and what today, it's a big difference. So luckily things were falling in my place and I was able to survive. And on the fourth year, I was like firmly on my ground. That's how then we approached some banks and we started importing the material on our own. And that's the journey of Denyup. As we realized that yes, we are growing, I need to grow further, I opened a warehouse in Sharjah, then we took a place in Abu Dhabi, then in Al Ain, and across all the UAE we took the location. Then we also decided, okay, we should geographically expand. We went to Oman, we went to Bahrain. While we were expanding, we realized that yes, then we need to make our infrastructure very strong, because unless you have the strong infrastructure, we can never expand in a big way. And that's how we entered to Jabal Ali 7 years ago. We approached the Jabal Ali people and we told them, look, our plans are so and so, and they were kind enough to give me a very good location on the main road, which you can see it right now, where we were able to build in the infrastructure in Jabal Ali. Today, by God's grace, we are one of the biggest tenants for them in Jabal Ali. Mm-hmm. We have almost 250,000 square feet of land we rented from there, plus another 100,000 is under pipeline. So it's a huge land we have taken on premises from there. But that, because of the infrastructure which we are able to develop and keep it, helped us in the boom type period. Between 2005 and 2008, there was a huge boom in the whole of Middle East. And at that time we were growing about 50-60% a year. But had we not made the infrastructure, probably would have not been able to do. So that was the right time that we were able to do the infrastructure. So coming back, I know I answered your question in a very long way, but I thought, let me tell you about the history of the Denyup and what Denyup is. And it didn't come as a silver spoon. We started from scratch and made Denyup to this level it is.
Tell us something about your people. Your people are your core strengths, is it not? You have some quality people in you, otherwise you would have never reached.
Absolutely. For any business to go to this level from nothing, it has to 100% depend on the people. And by God's grace, touch wood, I would say we always touch the wood, because in wood business we are in. We have been blessed with very good people. I have people working with me from the time we have started company. Like yesterday I was interviewing with ZTV and there were some people who came and spoke on that channel also, wherein I was very happy to hear that, you know, they are working with me for 15 years and 12 years and 13 years and they still don't feel like leaving us. So people are the, I would always say that, you know, I would have some ideas, but it's the people who will drive this company. And today with so much of expansion, we have gone across the region. We are expanding everywhere, and that's only because we are blessed with good people, and I'm very thankful that they are there with me and they're supporting us in this growth.
Tell us about your applauds, your certificates, your awards. Have you won any awards?
So we have 2010, I would say, was a recession for a lot of companies, but that was the best year, I would say, because we won 3 awards. One is the Dubai Quality Award, which was given to me by the son of Sheikh Mohammed.
Mm-hmm.
Then there was a Dubai Appreciation Award that was given to us by the another son of Sheikh Mohammed. Okay. Now, these are the two most important awards in Dubai. If anybody is residing in Dubai, he would know that how important this award is. It is like one of your prestigious awards which you have in India. So then the third icing on the cake was I also won the Businessman of the Year award. So 3 awards, we were able to get it in 2010. So it was a very lucky year, I would consider. So it's a good achievement, I would feel.
And then before coming here, I had browsed your website and it says Go Green. How have you gone green?
You see, what is happening is with this climatic change which is happening around the world, and with the resources for the electricity and all that, which is less in these getting lesser and lesser in this country. Our Sheikh Mohammed had come out with a thing that everybody has to go green. The reason of going green is like to curtail the using of the natural resources which we are having a use. Now, as a company, we have a limited thing to do green, but what is important is what we are importing some material which are produced according to the green technology.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why we call it as green. Now, it's not only producing, we need to really get it certified. And we are proud to say that we are one of the few companies in UAE, or I would say one of the first company in UAE, to get that certificate from the government, economic department and all that, that we can supply these green products in the market. So we have a substantial stock also of the green products. Anybody wants to buy green products, I know that we are the first one to be approached, and we keep that stock and we help the mission of Sheikh Mohammed, which is there, in driving it forward.
What about the health, safety, environment aspect, as we already mentioned, the green thing? Health, safety aspect.
Health, safety is very important in our business, because wood is a very inflammable material. So we have to be very, very careful. We follow all the health procedures according to the IOC standards. Not only that, because of these Dubai Quality Awards and the Dubai Appreciation Awards, when we had to get it, all these things had to be followed. And not only followed, we were doing it, to be honest, from the beginning, because had we not been doing it, we would have probably never got this award. So this was one of the criteria that to get this award, that what are we doing to follow the health and the safety regulations. So we follow it according to what is required as for the market.
And we heard that you're going big in Saudi Arabia.
Saudi Arabia, as you know, is a very, very big market, very huge market. If one can expand in Saudi Arabia, the business which we can get in Saudi Arabia will be as big as you can do from the rest of the region, which all of us know. But the only problem is not doing business in Saudi Arabia is not easy, as it's in Dubai or Oman, which also we know. Although the government there is also trying to help the expats to become more and more business friendly. So we are making our ways, and inshallah I'm sure we'll succeed. And we have big plans to go to Saudi Arabia and do our business in a bigger way. In fact, we have opened just our second showroom last month. We also plan to open our showroom in Riyadh and Al-Khobar very soon.
You have come from zero to hero and you're so simple. How do you maintain the simplicity?
I don't know. I would say...
And you're such a down-to-earth man when I was speaking to you before the shoot. So, big people are simple, or...
Yeah, I think it depends on person to person, nature to nature. My father was a very simple person. My mother is a simple person. My father is no more also. But it depends on the upbringing mostly, as to how you have been brought up. And success has never gone on my head. I always stayed on my ground, and that's what I advise all my people also, that even if you do some business or if you've done some big sale, don't allow it to go it on your head. Be on your ground, and that is the thing can only pay you. I mean, people make money, people earn money, but what is important for them is to keep that relationship, let people like you, and that is what is important today. So I believe in that, believe in simplicity, And touch wood, alhamdulillah, everything is going fine.
And welcome to Marine Biz TV. You're watching the world's first global maritime TV channel.
I'm sorry. I had problems at the port state control with my ship.
With the GL classified ship?
NK, dedicated to ensuring the safety of life and property at sea and the prevention of marine pollution. With 6,742 ships and over 150 million gross tons under class, we also represent 20% of the world merchant fleet under class. Class NK, truly world class.
What is your business mantra?
To be honest, it's number one is work, work, work. There's nothing which can succeed unless you decide that you're going to work and go into the detail of what you're doing in. You cannot say that you want to do a business or you want to do something and that can be left to somebody else. You really need to, if you want to be a master of something, you need to really get into the detail of that. Of course, at this moment, I don't go into the detail of each and everything because I've passed that stage. But if you want to succeed in something, then you really need to go into the detail of that. Second thing, mantra-wise, I would say that trust people, get the right people on the board. Delegate them. First important is get the right people on board. Once you know that they are the right people on board, give them the power, give them the delegation and let them do the work. Even if they make mistakes, they will make mistakes. You have made mistakes in your life, so they can also make mistakes. Third thing is keep smiling for any reason, anything goes wrong. This is what God has wanted it and keep forward.
What is so different in Danube? Why should people come to Danube?
Danube, number one, geographically we are present everywhere, so that is a big advantage which Danube has, that you know today we have 25 locations across all the Middle East, which is growing by every year. When I say growing by every year we plan to open 8 to 10 showrooms. So when you are geographically present close to your house, definitely you're going to come to the store. Now the other second factor, the USP of Danube is, I would say, is we have everything under one roof. Everything under one roof means you can buy from a steel or cement to any other product for the home interiors. We have also started now a company called Danube Buildmart, which is also dealing in the home furnishing, wherein you can buy everything from a tiles to sanitary to wallpaper to Venetian blinds to chandelier to whatever is required in the house, to windows to, you know, ceiling, everything required in the house is available in one store. Now that makes it a one-stop shop solution for everybody. So when you have, for a customer, what does he want? He wants that, okay, he goes to a place where he knows that he is buying from a good company, where the quality products are given to him. Then the second thing what he wants is everything is available to him under one roof. He doesn't have to go and shop in different places for another thing. Third thing, what he is looking at, the economical price, that the price is what is being charged is very reasonable. Fourth thing is after sales service. If anything goes wrong, then the company is there to take care of you. Now all these four things we are able to provide: number of products, prices, quality of the products, after sales service. So where does the customer have a choice? He has no other choice but to come to us.
Tell us something about your family. The success of every man depends on a woman. Is it true or false? Or in your
hundred thousand percent true. You see, a lot of people, I would say, are genius, probably much more genius than I am. A lot of people are working also much more harder than I would work. But that T factor, all this luck factor we say, is the most important in any business. In our company, we all know that my wife is my lucky charm. She is the one who really helps us. I don't know what she does, mantra she does, but she keeps praying that the company prosper. And we always consider that she is the lucky person. So whenever she is around, we'll try to bring her to the office and give her the honor of cutting the ribbon or whatever it is. So.
And your children?
I have one son. My one son is he's already 22 and a half now. He's studying still. But thank God that he is involved from the beginning. When he was 13, we put him into the business culture. And that thing has gone into his blood now. And hopefully after the education, he's going to come and join me. I have my brother also, who takes care of the interests of the company. He's the managing director of the company, and he is also involved in a big way in this company. So, plus his children are going to grow up. So, inshallah, the next generation also will take forward what we have already made it.
So, you want your son to directly come into the business, or do you want him to make a mistake with another person's money first and then join you?
No, I don't think. I would rather want him to come here.
The sooner the better.
The sooner the better, because he already has a lot of things to do here. Always we discuss better when you come in joining. So he says, soon I'm coming. And I want him to come in soon, because if he comes, then instead of, I'm sure that he will add in a lot of value, because the fresh blood, studying MBA now. So he's definitely going to come in and add in lots and lots of value. Luckily, he's also very down-to-earth person, very matured. So I'm sure he's going to help us in a lot.
What other things do you do apart from business? You have your...
if you ask me what I do to unwind, I would say I go for swim. Mm-hmm. That's what keeps my stress level a little bit down. I party a lot. So every weekend I have to party. I have a set of good friends. So we all sit together with our families and friends and children and all that. We would meet in some of the houses, in any one of the houses, and then we would party till 2 o'clock in the morning. So that's what keeps me going. I travel a lot also. So, but somehow we try to balance the work between the work and the extracurricular activity I'm doing. But I like to enjoy my life also. We go for movies. Me and my wife would go for movies separately whenever we want. So everything is there. So
you have found out time to blend between both professional and personal life.
Although more of my time goes into professional, but a little bit of time I do also give at home. But now my wife has gone used to it. Before she used to complain, but now she said, okay, no point in complaining. Let me live with this man as he is.
So, are you a God-fearing man?
I am not very, very God-fearing as my wife is, I would say. Everybody is God-fearing. All of us, we are God-fearing. If you ask me, do I pray 5 times? No, I don't pray 5 times. But at the same time, I believe in God. I am a very firm believer that there is an existence of somebody who is controlling all of us. And there is definitely a superpower where we need to respect him. We need to, pray to him. So she prays 5 times, I pray 2 times. That's the only difference. If you call me a God-fearing, yes, I am. If that level, I am a God-fearing. If you don't call me praying 2 times, I'm not a God-fearing. But we should all be a little bit of God should be there in our mind. Otherwise, the values and all that gets affected.
let's say your customers or your employees or somebody close to you is watching, what would you like to tell your, let's say your customers or people who want to become your customers, what would you like to say on behalf of Daniel?
As I told earlier, that the products which we are offering in the market are very quality products. I mean, today, you know, it's, we have reached a stage where money, we all of us, we have made. For us, our values, when you call it the vision, mission and the values which we want to, which we are trying to teach here to all the people concerned, that the integrity, we should do the business. So we want to offer our customers the best of the quality, where they feel that this is the company where we can rely on, this is the company where they can keep on coming back to us, and that is very important for me. So I tell my, this is what the, not only to my, all my customers, all my staff, when they join, the first thing we have given a book that, well, this is the mission, vision and the values of the company which you need to follow, and this has been drilled completely into their mind, so that nobody tries to cheat a customer or offer something extra to a customer which is not possible.
If I give you an option to be reborn again, who would you like to be reborn as? This one sergeant itself?
Yeah, I think I would like to be reborn as this one sergeant. Because I'm very happy in my life. I feel I have done very good compared to the way I have started. So that I would thank God that God has been very, very kind to all of us. He has given us more than what we deserve. So I would be very happy to be born again as one sergeant.
There's one thing where we go and ask everybody. The so-called financial storm or the recession, it has hit everybody, no matter Dubai, okay, to India, some extent they have survived, people say, but we don't know. But the world has been hit by recession. So you're doing business in volumes, so you could have definitely been hit. So how did you manage your company during these hardships?
First of all, this so-called recession, I always call it a so-called recession, was not because Dubai did something stupid.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It was because of somebody did stupid something in some part of the world which hit Dubai over here. Now, in Dubai, the people who were maximum hit by the recession are the people who diverted themselves from their core business.
Okay.
When I say that core business, people, suppose if you are in the textile, bringing and selling a textile goods, or you're selling a supermarket, and if you are continuing doing their own business, I don't think you would have been hit that much as had you been. So this sort of a business which you did not know what is happening, you started putting your money. And then what happened was that you put that $1, which made you $1.5, and you put another $2. That gave a greed to a lot of people over here, where they felt that overnight they could become rich. And the problem was that greed was so high, especially in Dubai. You must have noticed that people used to stand in from 6 o'clock in from the night to buy an apartment. When they had only 100,000 dirhams in their pocket, they would buy an apartment of 2 million dirham, thinking that that 2 million dirham is going to become 3 million dirham, and they would make that 1 million dirham or 2 million dirham profit out of it. Now that is where the people got hit. Now being in Danube, we also got carried away. We also, you know, got tempted. I wouldn't say got carried away, but we also got tempted many a times. Some mistakes we also did, but it's not possible being a human being, you know, with this such a big boom happening, that you would say that no, you're the only saint who got away from it. We also did some mistakes, but what was important was whenever we put our things into something, we used to always think, never think that how much it's going to go up. We used to always think, when we used to put our money, that how much it will go down. For example, you buy a property of 1,000 dirhams and you know that it can go up to 3,000 dirhams. This is what people used to imagine and put the money. But in our case, we used to think, okay, if 1,000 dirhams become 500 dirhams, can we sustain? And that is where we put our money. So, number one is we did not do anything other than the business which we are doing. Whatever small little we did, we made sure that we, whatever, if at all the business, it falls down, it is within our capacity. So we were able to manage. Now talking about all our core business, there also there was a problem where all of a sudden, you know, the liquidity started crashing and the prices started coming down and demand started diminishing. It was a difficult time, to be honest. It was not an easy time that I would say that the recession did not hit us. But then again, because we did not do anything stupid, because of the liquidity which was coming here, some of the bankers came and asked me, Ridwan, what happened? How are you going to survive? So I told same thing to the bankers, because I haven't done anything stupid. I haven't bought anything extra which is required and which my demand was not that I've created. I did not, like for example, when the steel prices were going so much high, instead of 10,000 tons, people used to import 50,000 and 60,000, 70,000 tons, thinking that they're making money. I said that we did not overtrade in anything. We imported what was required in the market. And so now the question is liquidity. If liquidity is not coming, I can't help it. It's the whole thing has been hit by the recession. But this is not going to stay for a longer time. Give us some time. Within 6 months, 9 months, we should be able to overcome this problem. And the banks were there, they understood that yes, we are serious people, we are genuine people, we have not done anything stupid. They supported, to be honest. We are the only person in the building material, I would say, one of the few person in building material, I would say, where during the recession also the banks were all out to support us. There was not a single time that our LCs or a credit limit was full because there was a recession in the market. But as far as I know, there were a lot of people where the banks pulled themselves back and they would not open the credit. So this is very important. I mean, a message to all the people that, you know, when you go through such period, don't get carried away. Never think that how much is going to go up. Always think that how much it can go down and whether you can take that hit or not.
Thank you very much. It was nice talking to you. And let me wind up the statement that there is nothing wrong in saying that Rome was not built in a day, neither were you.
Thank you, sir.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful experience speaking to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, and wish to see you next time in a bigger, bigger, bigger heights.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.